This is a pregnant seahorse. Dead. Yes, in the world of seahorses, it is the dead that gives birth. We wanted to capture this rare moment on camera, which only few people have been able to do.
Oh my gosh, they're so tiny!
Leading up to this moment, we learned about the insane biology of seahorses and discovered an underwater romance defying all odds. As these delicate creatures are now threatened with extinction, meaning that each new baby increases the chance of survival for their species. So we sent Rochella from Planet Wild to team up with the leading seahorse scientists to build literal underwater hotels for our elusive friends and help restore their habitat and population, all in one of the world's most iconic places, Sydney Harbour. We're Planet Wild. Welcome to Mission 25.
Sydney Harbour must be one of the most recognizable places on the planet. I mean, it's also a site of great human achievement. We've got the iconic Opera House, Sydney Harbour Bridge, not to mention all this busyness. But there's a different kind of bustling metropolis here in Sydney too, and that one is out there. Sydney Harbour is actually a biodiversity hotspot, home to 675 species of fish. That's more than the entire Galapagos Islands in just this harbour. Let that sink in for a moment. Going for a snorkel here will bring you face to face with cuttlefish, octopus, sharks, and if you're lucky, the white seahorse. White seahorses aren't actually white. They're named after this guy. They often appear brown, black, or even yellow. But like all seahorses, they can change their skin tone to blend in with their environment. And that's not the only trait they share with chameleons. And, well, actually, hang on a sec. What actually is a seahorse? Like, what even is it? Is it some kind of fusion between an octopus and a starfish? Or maybe the merging of a sea cucumber and a horse? That's not it. It's actually much simpler than that. A seahorse is a fish. Like all fish, they breathe using gills, they have fins to push themselves through the water, and they control their buoyancy with an internal swim bladder. But clearly they're not like other fish. They don't have scales, they don't have teeth, and they don't have a stomach. But how did they get to be so horsey? Well, about 50 million years ago, early seahorses resembled pipefish, with long bodies that swam horizontally. And it was the evolution of their seagrass habitat that sparked significant changes for them. Seahorses developed their upright posture and curled tails in order to anchor themselves to seagrass blades and remain stationary. So they're not great swimmers, but still, they are great hunters. Clinging to the seagrass, they wait until their tiny prey gets close, and then, you missed it, didn't you? That's because they are rapid. They whip their heads around and opening their mouths creates a vortex that sucks their prey into it. This method makes them one of the most effective ocean predators, with a hit rate of 90%. That's twice as effective as a great white shark. But because of these specific adaptations, these tiny creatures are very habitat dependent. Sadly, that makes them incredibly vulnerable. Here in Sydney, their habitat has changed dramatically. It's easy to forget, but a few hundred years ago, this place looked completely different. Before Europeans arrived in Australia, Indigenous peoples stewarded this area of the coastline, calling it Warrain. It's hard to imagine what a paradise it must have been. But during the course of colonization, the Industrial Revolution, and multiple world wars, the harbour changed irreversibly. During the 1970s and 80s, Sydney Harbour was booming. And while this meant wealth for the city, it also meant the destruction of native sea life. At one point, the water in the harbour was so polluted with fuel and nasty chemicals that it could literally catch on fire. Fast forward to today, and the harbour is a much cleaner place. But the seahorse habitats are still shrinking fast. In fact, the area has 40% less seagrass than it did in 2010 and is no longer able to support the population of white seahorse. And this is due to several factors, including ongoing coastal developments that push the coastline out into the water, regular boat traffic and damage from anchors scraping the seafloor, and, of course, the effects of climate change, which leads to more frequent storms that tear up seagrass meadows. All of this has led to a catastrophic decline in the numbers of the white seahorse, up to 90% in some parts of the harbour. And now, they're in danger of being lost for good. Luckily, there's an Aussie scientist who is helping the seahorse make a comeback. Mitchell Brennan is the head of the Sydney Seahorse Project.
Seahorses, I think, are absolutely fascinating, so different from most other animals that we see. And there's something that I really have a fascination with. So I've wanted to work with them for a long, long time since I was little, and I've really been pursuing that.
The Sydney Seahorse Project is dedicated to bringing the white seahorse back to Sydney in big numbers. But as you might imagine, that's no easy task. To do it, we first have to make more baby seahorses. And that means diving into the complex and rather fascinating world of seahorse love. See, seahorses are completely monogamous, staying with the same partner throughout their 4 to 6 year lifespan. And to strengthen their bond, pairs perform intricate courtship dances, often intertwining their tails for hours. Talk about romance. And once that pair bond is established and the couple gets together, then it's actually the male who gets pregnant. Okay, more on that in a sec. But in the wild, babies only have a 1% chance of survival because they're easily gobbled up by predators. So Mitch raises them here in the safety of the lab, where their chances are boosted up to 20%. So he actually goes out into the harbor in search of male seahorses who are already pregnant. He collects them and brings them back to the lab to give birth. But don't worry, after the birth, Mitch takes the male back to the exact piece of kelp or seagrass where he was collected, so that this lifetime pair is reunited. Inside this tank is a pregnant male seahorse that Mitch collected on a recent dive. And he could give birth at any time, any day, nature. Unpredictable. So we're going to do everything we can to capture this very rare and very special moment. Good luck, buddy. We'll come check on you soon.
All done. Crossing fingers.
Seahorses are actually one of three creatures who reproduce this way, all belonging to the family Cygnathidae. Oh yeah, there's also a creature called a sea dragon, and it looks like this. Pretty amazing, right? Let us know if we should make a video about those in the future. But for now, let's get back to seahorse sex. First, the female transfers her eggs into a special chamber on the male's abdomen, called a brood pouch. He then incubates them until they're ready to be born. But why? Well, it's a bit of a mystery, but the best theory is that this evolutionary quirk essentially doubles the rate of reproduction by allowing the females to start producing new eggs while the male is incubating the current batch. But how about the moment of truth?
Mitch is in the lab and he's just sent through some exciting news. Okay. I'll be calm. Oh my gosh, they're so tiny! Oh. Hey Dad, you've given birth! This is so cool! Aren't you a proud papa?
That looks really amazing.
About 100 fully formed baby seahorses have popped out into the tank. Each one only a few millimeters in length, but totally independent of their parents. Our brand new babies, or seahorse fry, now need a lot of care and attention from Mitch and his team. And we wanted to help. So the Planet Wild community is funding the lab to raise 300 to 500 baby seahorses.
We will be holding them here in the nursery, feeding them, cleaning the tanks, making sure that their environment is as good as possible.
So you're kind of like their babysitter.
Babysitter of over 400 babies at a time.
Once they've grown to 6 centimeters long, we'll release them back into the ocean. But before that, the team inserts a microscopic tag just underneath the skin. This allows them to monitor babies, but also for them to tell the difference between those born here in the lab and those born in the wild.
We've just tagged these two seahorses here, and you can see the tag sitting just under their skin. Now, if I shine this UV torch onto it, you'll see it fluoresce, and that really helps us to find them and identify the tags under the water. Our team here at the Sydney Seahorse Project has released over 1,000 endangered white seahorses, and we're expecting to release over 1,000 more this year.
But to have the best chance of survival, the babies need a home. As we know, seahorses have evolved to curl around blades of seagrass, but the seagrass habitat has shrunk so much that it's really tough out there for a baby seahorse. And that is where this thing comes in. These are seahorse hotels. Yes, they don't look like much right now. In fact, they look more like a prison than they do a hotel. But trust me, these ugly metal structures are specifically designed to be a safe haven for seahorses. So we are providing the seahorses with three brand new hotels. In just a few weeks, these barren metal bars will start to transform, and eventually, they'll look like this. A semi-natural reef that acts as an oasis for many different marine species, including the white seahorse.
So it provides them with the habitat that they need, but it also provides them with the opportunity to camouflage so they can hide from predators, and it brings along the food sources that they like to eat as well.
In the areas where these hotels have been installed, the seahorse population has increased by as much as 250%. So these three new hotels that we're sinking now serve as the perfect temporary home for our baby seahorses. But the main objective is to bring back their natural forever home, the seagrass. That's why we're going even further and funding 500 square meters of seagrass regeneration in Sydney Harbour over the next 2 years. Jack is a seagrass wizard. His work starts when a storm hits and tons of seagrass gets uprooted and beached. Once this happens, they will never be able to re-anchor. Or so we thought. Jack and his team collect these shoots and nurse them back to health in these drums. After about 3 years, these grass blades actually go back to the seabed. But all this has to be painstakingly planted blade by blade, together with long metal pins that will secure the roots if a big storm comes through here. The area is also marked and protected so that no boats or anchors will disrupt this growing seagrass meadow. With this protection, hundreds of species will be able to thrive here, and sooner than you think. Normally, it could take centuries for seagrass meadows to establish, but with all this hard work, it could take as little as 5 to 10 years to turn this into this.
We can ensure that people will have the opportunity, just like I did, to come out here and see these seahorses thriving in the wild.
Now it's finally time to get out there and release our babies.
We're stoked. They're big, they're healthy. We've tagged them. They're ready to go out into the wild, and yeah, we're ready to see them off.
As soon as we get below the surface, Mitchell's seahorse hotels appear through the gloom. These were sunk several months ago, but already they are teeming with life. So much coral and sea sponges clinging to the structure. When we find the perfect spot, it's finally time to release our babies so that they can continue the cycle of life.
And now it's up to each and every one of those little guys to make it on their own. Having grown up in the safety of Mitch's aquarium, they have a much, much higher survival rate than they usually would. That's our way of giving nature an extra boost to help it recover. And once they have found their partner for life, the newly planted seagrass meadow ensures that they have all they need to settle down, as it also brings back hundreds of other species that together make up this beautiful underwater ecosystem just beneath the iconic Sydney Harbour. And we're not stopping here. Every single month, we go on a mission to bring back endangered species, protect our oceans, and rewild entire landscapes. Make sure to subscribe so you don't miss our next one. And you can even become part of these missions yourself by joining Planet Wild as a backer, because everything you see here is 100% community funded by people just like you and me. There's a link in the description and a QR code right over here. See you all again next month. Over and out.
So I just got an email from Mitch, and I have to share it with you. Mitch says, good news, the male we released back into the wild, I saw again last week sitting with his partner. Super cute to know that they have definitely rekindled their love. Oh, go Seahorse love!